But okay, we can start with the question, what was there before the Big Bang? A kind of Platonic archetype or God, or Steve Gould is thinking, am I going all the way to Hilversum just for answering rubbish questions? Yeah. Or not?
It's not a question we can take up. Anything you say is largely expressive of a whole set of personal biases that it would take hours on the couch to unravel.
And it may not even be a...
But it's a very profound and important question for science, and it's my own starting point. Namely, that if we take evolution as a theory referring only to life, we're dealing with a very, very narrow section of a cosmic evolutionary process. And when we actually take the view of the Big Bang, assuming there was one, although most scientists refuse to discuss metaphysical questions and certainly don't want to have God in the picture at all, or if they do, have a kind of neo-deism where he just starts it off, lights the touch paper or something. In fact, there's an implicit assumption throughout the whole of science that all the laws of nature are fixed and that they were all there at the moment of the Big Bang. Whether they were there before it or not is an implicit assumption that runs through the thinking of most scientists. And it isn't explicitly formulated. It's present in the implicit assumption that any experiment ought to be repeatable anywhere, anytime. The implicit assumption is that the laws of the nature are the same everywhere, at all times and in all places.
No, that's really not so. That's something we are testing all the time.
I've not met anyone testing it. Can you tell me how you're testing it?
Looking at these ancient objects in the sky and verifying whether their spectra follow the same laws as the ones down here. And we have very direct knowledge of things that were going on only one quarter of the age of the universe. And
but by assuming that the laws were constant, you have to assume
the speed of light is constant, for instance. In order to arrive at any judgments about these early events.
No,
we don't.
You have things you observe and which you can compare with things that happen nowadays. And so far, the evidence is very strong that they behave the same way. But that's by no means taken for granted. But in fact, it's one of the very interesting open questions. Mm-hmm. And there are very few really good tests, but such as there are, they've always turned out negative.
For example?
Well, for example, the fine structure of the lines in the quasar, which, I don't need to get into the technicalities here, but this is a very direct piece of evidence that it has, when you look at the fine structure of carbon at one quarter of the age of the universe, it turns out to look exactly the same as it does now.
Well, you see, I think it's perfectly possible that laws, that the behavior of carbon hasn't changed for three quarters of the age of the universe. But since I myself think the regularities of nature are more like habits, that I would have said that's a habit built up much earlier on, and they get pretty constant.
That's a perfectly sensible hypothesis. Mm. I mean, we don't go back that far, of course.
But if you're putting forward a theory where the regularities exhibited by, say, carbon atoms are really just habitual, it's a world of habit, doesn't that presuppose a sort of law of habit? Why should habits behave the same from the Big Bang to the present? Aren't you yourself actually presupposing a regularity which then you use as the basis to explain these other regularities?
Yes, I'd concede that you need
some. There's one law.
Well, I would say there's a principle of habit in nature, but I would say it's without specific content. In other words, that the law would simply be that self-organizing patterns through repetition become more probable. But it wouldn't say which self-organizing principles come into being, and that there'd be a radical contingency. I think habit is a much deeper and more important principle in nature than we usually think. Law is the preferred metaphor in science, an extremely anthropocentric metaphor based on human laws, which in fact do evolve, of course.
Habit isn't anthropocentric?
No, because animals have habits. animals don't have laws. It's only human beings that have laws. So I would say the metaphor of laws is much more intensely anthropocentric than the metaphor of habit. It's obvious dogs and cats have habits. It's obvious we have them. So we could say that at least we can broaden the spectrum of habit to include most forms of animal that we know. Habituation, which is a kind of habit formation, occurs in unicellular organisms, but laws don't. So I would say this is an intensely anthropocentric metaphor.
The sun rises every day. It's pretty law-like.
Not at all law-like. It's habit-like. You can see it either way. I mean, there are some people I know who...
David Hume commented on that. I well remember, but...
But look, Rupert, I mean, you know, if you look at this historically, the fact is that it's not anthropocentric, it's theocentric. You may say the model of God, which is itself an anthropocentric model, an anthropomorphic model, but... When the idea of constant laws was seriously emphasized in the sciences, which wasn't until well into the 17th century, I mean, it was part of a particular theological vision of the universe. So that, I mean, what's interesting about your choice of the word, I don't know if you've ever looked up Aquinas on the subject of habitus, but I mean, there is a, you know, I suspect you have a more respectable intellectual ancestry than you would like to believe.
I'm nothing against Aquinas, I'm in favor of it.
Yes, fine, the idea that what we're interested in understanding are these habitus, you know, and that this is, I think this is a, you know, this is a good part of a traditional Aristotelian point of view. It's interesting that, really, how late it was that people came to this conviction that the laws of nature were constant. There was absolute doubt about it before, about the middle of the 17th century. It was really a matter of great dispute. And I mean, one reads Sir Thomas Browne on how the entire universe is in decay, how the greater part of time has gone than is to come, and how we may expect the present dispensation to be dissolved any day now. Until you were prepared to believe that the universe was capable of going on for thousands and millions of years in the future, it was really... one was open to these kind of apocalyptic ideas that it was all going to fall apart because there wasn't anything like laws of nature to sustain our conviction that the thing would keep going.
Mm. Or if there were laws, as in... Burnett's 17th century geology and others, they were only for that short period of a few thousand years between the divine creation and the coming suspension of those laws for end of things.
Yeah.
But that is, in fact, I agree with you entirely. The idea of eternal laws of nature is a theological, mechanistic, scientific, theological mixture of those in the 17th century, a construction which, now that the mind of God's been dissolved away from the world machine for most scientists, they're left free-floating as a kind of habitual assumption in the minds of most scientists. And
I want to see just how radical your thesis is. On your view, did triangles just gradually acquire the habit of having, right triangles, of having the square on their hypotenuse be equal to the sum of the squares on the side? Is pi just a habitual ratio between the... circumference and the diameter?
Well, I mean, this is a big question, isn't it? Is mathematics constructed or is it discovered? I mean, it's a huge philosophical question, and it's not one that I'm terribly concerned with myself. I don't think that there are many right triangles in nature, you see. I think if we get too bogged down in this question, we're dealing with the history of human mathematics. Mm. And it's very easy and very natural for mathematicians to be Platonists, to assume that what they discover, what they find, is somehow a kind of eternal, self-subsistent realm of truth.
Well, at least it's timeless.
It's timeless. That's right, but I'm not very interested in right triangles and pi. I'm more interested in nature as we observe it, rather than mathematical theories per se.
My point was just that